morning. My name is Brian Mahoney. I'm a geologist on the expedition team aboard the Seaboard Venture. We're addressing you today from the Nays on James Ross Island on the western edge of the Weddell Sea. This spectacular place is home to all kinds of really cool rocks we've landed to investigate. The orange rocks you see behind me are part of the Cape Lamb Formation, which is filled with all kinds of ammonites and belemnites and inoceramids, these really cool late Cretaceous marine fossils showing this was a warm water environment 66 to 68 million years ago. The rocks on top over there are what's called the Sandwich Butte Member. The Sandwich Butte Member is famous because it contains the remains of these spectacular late Cretaceous dinosaurs that were vicious predators swimming in the late Cretaceous oceans. We also found some new stuff. We found there's a bunch of this intrusive igneous rock that formed from a molten material. That molten material intruded into the rocks I just described, and as it did so, it formed these large hydrothermal explosion breccias and then large columnar joints as the magma cooled following the deposition of these sediments. So we've got evidence of warm water here at 66 to 68 million years, and sometime after that we got lots of volcanic activity creating these intrusive rocks that form these spectacular cliffs we have beside me.
Hi, I'm Dr. Sean Todd. I'm one of the marine mammal specialists on board the Seaboard Venture. And behind us, you can see a strait which we were in last night, and we were treated to this amazing sight of orcas, a group of about 30 animals right at sunset. So the light was absolutely beautiful. The light was coming through the blows of the animal. So you saw these so-called rain blows. And we could tell from the types of animals we were seeing and from their morphology and their coloration that these were what we call B2 ecotypes. In other words, these are animals that were penguin specialists. They're after penguins. And you could also tell from the fact that every single penguin we saw that at that time was not in the water, it was indeed in the ice.
Hello, I'm Jim Glover, one of Seabourne Ventures naturalists, and we're here today, the sun's actually just broken through, on Petermann Island. And It's a beautiful day, the wind's dropped, and we're in the middle of a large gentoo colony. And the gentoos have had a bad season this year. We've been visiting here in the last 2 months, three or four times, and there's been a huge amount of snow, much more than they normally would be. This is a result of climate change. It's ironic that there's actually more snow. Normally this is a very dry place. And the gentoo penguins really can't breed successfully in deep snow. They need to keep their egg warm and dry. And if they warm their egg up, then of course it doesn't remain dry in the snow. So although it's mostly gentoo penguins here, they've got one or two chin straps and one or two adelie, a small colony of adelie behind me on the other side of the island. And together with them, there's a small colony of Antarctic shags. So quite a good variety of birds. A lot of people have been asking about the wooden cross that's just off to my left, and that's quite a sad story really. In 1981, three British research workers, in the winter, they were based in a British base just across the water. They skied across on the ice, which because it was all frozen, but when they got here, there was a violent storm, the ice broke up and they couldn't get back, and there's a refuge hutch just behind us. And so they were able to stay there for quite a long time, nearly 3 months. And they had radio contact with the outside world. And then when the sea refroze again, they decided to try and make it. But they headed off and sadly were never seen again. And the cross is in memory of their loss.
I'm Elizabeth Pierce, and I'm a historian and archaeologist on this voyage. Today we're here at Damoy Point. It started off as a very, very snowy and wet morning, but it's cleared up nicely, and we're able to enjoy the huts and the penguins that are living in the area. To one side, I have an Argentinian refuge hut, and those are still found throughout the peninsula. Even today, people, travelers, or researchers who get stuck in bad weather can still use them for refuge. And behind me is a hut that was used as a British base. And at one point, several people would have been living in this very small space, but we can see how they live today. They would have lived together, worked together, and celebrated holidays together. And on the ridge behind me used to be a skiway or a runway for planes that were flying to British bases farther south. Sometimes those planes would land, and then they couldn't take off again because of weather, sometimes for several days. So there'd be even more people stuffed into the hut. Thank you.
We're here at Deception Island. Deception Island was named because from the outside it looks like it's a big island, but when you find the little entrance into the caldera, you realize it is a big volcanic island. It's only about 6,000 years old, and there were eruptions back in the 1960s and 70s. But it's a fantastic place to come and visit. It feels a little bit like walking on the moon, perhaps. We've taken a number of hikes around the island. There's a wonderful 4 kilometer hike behind me in the distance that brings you up to some pretty incredible views of the landscapes here. We've got Weddell seals around us on either end of the beach. There's lots of skuas, and we've even had a light-phased giant petrel flying around visiting the shoreline as well. That's a pretty spectacular place, and I imagine everybody's had a pretty good experience here hiking around.